Hello, my name's Samantha Knox. I am a junior, currently in McMurray, and I did not put the date on this. Okay, the group that I picked for the presentation is people that have been diagnosed with mental disabilities, or not mental disabilities, mental illnesses, psychiatric illnesses. I've been working on the first person first phrasing, because I keep saying mental ill and crazy and all that. Anyway, through my research, I found some things out about the history of the treatment. Before the 1800s, people with psychiatric disorders were largely cared for by their family in a private setting. If they could not afford it, they would go to almshouses, similar to like a shelter. And that's only if they didn't have any family or any means to take care of themselves. The only time they became a state issue or a government issue is if they were becoming a nuisance to society or harming themselves or others. During the 1800s, though, and there was an increase in hospitalization, and by the end of the 1800s, nearly every state had at least one mental health hospital. Some of the treatments that they had was, an example is, the picture there is a holding chair, sorry. And they used that to deprive the person of sensory stimuli, because one of the theories at the time was that mental illness was caused by the brain not processing the stimuli properly, which caused mental illness. So they got deprived sensory deprivation with the illness. During the 1900s, treatment progressed a little bit, as they say. In 1936, the U.S. saw its first lobotomy performed, and then later on, electrocompulsive therapy came into play. It was used heavily towards the middle of the century, but then it became less and less. There's much more restrictions against how to use it, certain steps they have to go through to get it approved. Now, in the best case scenario, a person with a psychiatric disorder is treated with medication and therapy. That's the best case. Worst case, they end up homeless on the streets or stuck in an institution somewhere or just ignored. Some of the stereotypes that are still relevant in society today is that they're crazy. There's funny crazy, like the cat lady off The Simpsons, and there's scary crazy, like Norman Bates and Psycho, that split personality disorder or dissociative disorder. They're resistant towards treatment, that they don't want to get better, that you can't rely on them, that they don't show up for their appointments when they're supposed to, they don't follow through with the treatment recommendations that you give them. Some people believe that someone has a mental illness because there's something wrong with them morally, maybe they didn't come from a good family or something like that, that there's no good outcomes, the person's always going to be sick, always going to be the same, and that they're a burden to society. And I put that because a lot of the times, mental health treatment, substance abuse treatment is attacked when it comes to budgeting time. They always want to cut the budgeting. Personal prejudice, this is what I've had throughout my life. Not all of these are still prevalent with me, but some of them do, like the embarrassment, the shame, the fear for my future and actions. There are times when I'm working with someone who's not following through and not treating other people the way they should be, such as, you know, going and abusing their child, not their child, but, you know, just being abusive. I still have in the back of my mind that those actions are deliberate, that they mean to do that because they're just bad people. And it's not. Sometimes if someone keeps running away from home, that might be a symptom of their mental illness. If they don't follow through, that could be a symptom of their mental illness, especially when it comes to medications and therapies. The ways that I have discriminated, these are also things that I've done throughout my life. I've decreased them quite a bit. I still find my documentation still tends to be on the negative side, especially if I'm having to document someone's behaviors who may be coming in to where I work. I have to present that to the nurse and the doctor for their approval. And I tend to focus on this is what the person is, and not this is what they're doing to get better. And victim blaming goes right into that. Well, you can get better if you want to. I have someone close to me that has social anxiety disorder so severe that they cannot go into a store. There have been times in my past where I've gotten so frustrated with them. I go, fine, go to the store. Why don't you go to the store? I don't have time to go to the store. Why don't you go? Knowing that they can't do that and knowing that it makes them feel bad. Ways that my family and culture have reinforced these. I have a long family history of mental illness. My father has schizoaffective disorder. He was in and out of my life a lot. He used suicide as a manipulating tool. to get what he wanted. But you try telling that to a 17-year-old, you know, they're not going to process that correctly. So there was a lot of shame, secrets. When stuff actually did come out about my father, it turned from ignoring it to pushing him away and ridiculing him. The idea of the rugged individualism that Professor Williams had mentioned earlier, actually multiple times throughout the class, plays into it because we believe that people should be able to take care of themselves. If someone's mentally ill and they're believed that they should take care of themselves, they're not going to go seek treatment and they're just going to get worse. Portrayals in media such as news, tabloids, entertainment, I touched on with the Cat Lady and Norman Bates with our entertainment. News and media, anytime there's a shooting, anytime there's something that's going on, the person that did it, their mental stabilities come into play. And that's offensive towards people that have actual mental illnesses. And tabloids, every time a celebrity does something crazy, does something, there we go, I did it, does something that is out of their character, they are deemed crazy. What's wrong with that person? Some of the goals, I put a lot of words up here, so I'll just go through them quickly. The first one's education. I want to educate myself on how to better work with people, especially with borderline personality disorders, stuff that would affect their follow through. And I do that by, there's a training that's available at my work that I'll be completing, and also the physician of where I work so that I could sit in on a couple of sessions and kind of just see how they relate. Another one, my second goal would be to develop more fully my awareness of the bias that I have against people with it, or in their actions, and accepting, work on accepting people. The way I would do that is to just continue to acknowledge my negative thoughts and feelings, and even going to a supervisor and kind of reviewing, like, hey, this is what's happening in my mind when this is going on. What can I kind of do to decrease that? And also, when I do have a negative thought or feeling, just make it, just acknowledge it, and then come up with a positive counter to it. Third, I've decreased my bias by accepting my family's history of psychiatric illness. I found online through Mental Health Services of Central Illinois, a support group that is in Springfield, and it's the National Alliance of Mental Health Mental Illnesses Support Group for Families. I want to go to that 3 times. And then also develop a plan that I can use when I go to family functions in case when the inevitable, you know, they start talking about the crazy people in our family. The questions I had, the first one I asked her, the person that I interviewed was a Caucasian female between the age of 20 and 35. And her first question I asked her was about her most vivid, earliest vivid memory. And she said that it was about a boy chasing her around the schoolyard and calling her fat. And that just threw me back because the person that I saw when I was interviewing her is not, you would never guess ever, even anybody could ever call us fat. And two, it kind of hit home because even though we were physically different and, you know, she had a psychiatric disorder and I don't, we still had similar experiences. The next question I asked her was about the one about if people in school knew one thing about you that was surprising, what would it be? And she spoke about suicide, that they wouldn't know that she had suicidal thoughts and that she thought that they were normal in high school. And that just kind of pushed down the thought that I've always had, that suicide was a deliberate action, that people think about it because they want to think about it. And this answer, you know, made me realize that no, people that think about it don't want to think about it. It's just sometimes it's something that happens. The next question I had was the one of the 3 wishes, and her wishes were that she wanted to decrease animal cruelty, wanted to love herself, and wanted to eradicate judgment of other people in the world. And I, the basic theme of all that is just love, and the Beatles were actually like playing in my head. And then the next question I asked was about the best work experience she had, and she said working with the developmentally delayed. She worked with children and adults. That stuck to me, you know, that hit me because I've worked with developmentally delayed adults with a service here in town, and I loved it. It was very rewarding. She kind of like had the same feeling. Next interview question I had was about the goals as a parent. She does not have any kids, but her parental goals were the same as mine. You know, we just want to raise compassionate, competent adults, and that showed me that no matter what the diagnosis is, we all have the same goals. It's just that sometimes when we have a diagnosis, the plans get derailed a little bit. We have to work a little bit harder. The next one was about, have you ever had your heart broken? And she said yes, and heartbreak is universal. And the question about what she's most proud of, and it's just overcoming the past, you know, having the bipolar disorder diagnosis thrown on her, having depression, you know, suicidal thoughts when she was younger, just overcoming it. And that is what I have.
All right, as she's stepping down and Tawanda is going up, let's give her